Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Astrox Imperium. This is DEVLOG video number 97. We're taking a look at build 127, and today's date is the 7th of January, 2022. 777. All right. Already you can see we've got some goodies to show off here. Although this update is mainly focused on fixing issues and tweaking things across the board in various different areas, and I'll walk you through some of the stuff that I've done here. I did manage to get something working that I have been playing around with for some time now, and it has been quite a struggle to learn how to build these shaders for Unity, but we'll get into that towards the end of this video. But first I want to talk about some of the stuff that's been going on. You know, we had a big update in 126 where we changed a lot of the database stuff, and we've made a lot of changes to some of the mechanics and the way things are working, because, you know, we've got enough of the functionality here that it's time to do a balance pass, and I needed to go through and you know, it's been a couple years since some of those things have been tweaked. And so I just took my time and went through and made a lot of those changes, and I was aware that those changes could have repercussions throughout the game. So some of those repercussions, some of the issues that players have run into in the past 10 days, 2 weeks or so, have now been addressed, and this update focuses mostly on fixing a lot of those issues. And like I said, I did manage to squeeze some goodies in there, and I'll show that to you at the end. All right, let's talk about missions. So there's been a lot of confusion, and I've noticed some forum chatter about when the missions will appear to you and how they will become available and things like that. Initially, what was happening was the number of missions that you were completing was giving the game a gauge on how well you were doing and what missions to open up for you. And I think probably just a lack of my programming ability made it not as functional and not as enjoyable, and it wasn't opening up the missions fast enough, and it wasn't, you know, it didn't really matter if I played with that little slider that would determine when they would open up faster. It just seems like they weren't becoming available when you were capable of doing those missions. So with 126, what I had done is gone through the mission database and changed a lot of things that kind of were dealing with the levels and when those missions would become available. And by going through and changing it, for example, some of the kill missions wouldn't become, you know, they were considered like level 6 missions, meaning they wouldn't become available to you until you hit that mission level of level 6, which was calculated by the code. So what I've done now is I've changed that, and I've tried, and you probably have noticed I've done this throughout the entire database in 126, where I've tried to actually just streamline things a little bit more and make them less complicated, less convoluted, and just much more easier and straightforward to understand. So now what I've done is I've scaled the missions so that you can get level 1 raider missions, you can get level 1 kill missions. It's just they're not going to be giving you the same type of stuff that they would when you're getting the level 10s, and obviously you're not going to be getting paid the amount of money you'll be getting paid when that you'd get for those higher level missions or those base pay on those missions. So what that has done is made these missions become more available to newer players so that you don't feel like you have to, that you're forced to grind through a bunch of mission types that you don't enjoy just to open up the types of missions that you do enjoy. So I have addressed that, and what I've done to kind of still put some type of cap in there is to tie in the player level into that those missions, and when those missions, the chance that those missions will become available to you, will also is not only being calculated to some degree with the missions completed, but also using the level of your pilot. So right now it feels a lot better, and I've already got some positive feedback on the forums about it. So hopefully we continue in this direction and get these suckers balanced up. Now I probably will go through and make some more tweaks when it comes time to balancing out the earning potential, where I will go through and kind of tweak the base values for how much you harvest, how much you're earning from missions, how much you can gather from doing trade throughout the stations, so that things relatively seem somewhat similar, and then I can just slightly tweak them to where, you know, the easiest of the profiteering would be, you know, mining, and then slowly working your way up through the different ways of making money, so that the things that are more difficult are going to be more rewarding, and the things that are pretty straightforward and mindless are not going to be as rewarding. All right, so that pretty much covers the mission stuff. Actually, there were two missions that we were having some issues with that were dealing, that were really complicating things. And it really, it was just my fault. The way that I had it coded was not, it was not checking all the possible conditions that would allow you to complete that mission. And the missions I'm talking about are the kill raider missions, I'm sorry, the kill pilot missions, kill and recover, and the recover crate missions. So basically any mission where you were required to recover items out of a crate. What was happening, I'm just gonna fly around here so you're not looking at a yuck screen. What was happening was you were basically, you know, getting a crate mission, and then you would go out to that crate and you would discover that you didn't have enough room in the crate to carry the objects that you needed. Maybe you had picked up some ore or something. So you took one object out of the crate and then you put some ore in the crate to make room to take the other object, and the game would not detect that you had completed the mission or that your mission objectives were complete. Because the way I had it set up, it was checking to see that the crate was empty rather than making sure that the items that you needed out of the crate were empty. And then, of course, there was a secondary issue that led to an exploit where you would basically go and gather the item out of the crate. You couldn't carry it all, and you didn't have anything else in your cargo. So you run to the nearest station and drop off the item, and you go back to the crate and pick up the other item, no problem. However, if that crate, if you were in a station where that crate had spawned where there were no stations there and you had to go to another map and you left the sector, when you returned to the sector, the game would respawn that crate again with the full count of items in it, which would lead to exploitation. So now what is happening is the crate is, the game is going to check to see if the actual items have been removed from the crate. So what this does is opens up all those options where you can move things in and out of the crate without destroying the game object or the mission objective. And then once you've removed that final last item that is required from that crate, then the game detects that you have now removed all of those items and I will no longer spawn that crate. So you can leave the map and come back and the crate will not respawn because technically you have removed every single item from that crate. Now, all the items that you need for the missions, maybe there was some ore left in the crate or something else you put in that crate. But the things that you needed to complete that mission, those had been removed. And once those are removed, that will trigger the objective complete. Now, whether or not you bring all those items to the return location, that's up to you. If you decide to sell them or not complete the mission, you're not going to get any more crates that spawn with extra items. So at that point, you have to be careful because if you do anything with those items, you're not going to be able to complete the mission. Or you're going to have to go find a replacement item to get the quantity that's required to complete that mission. And then the same thing is happening with the kill recover missions. The only difference being that when you kill the raider, it is now going to trigger the mission objective that it has been partially completed. You won't see anything show up on the screen. I don't think the mission object shows up until the items have been removed. So you can kill the raider. The raider drops the crate. Now you leave the system. The raider does not respawn anymore. You've already killed him. Or the pilot, excuse me. I keep saying raider. So you've killed the pilot. The pilot will not respawn anymore, but now the crate is sitting in the system. You don't touch the crate, you leave the system, you come back, the crate spawns. Only the crate will be there. You open the crate, you take half of the items, you put them in your cargo bay, you leave the system, you come back, only the crate will be there, only half the items will be remaining in the crate. So what that does, it removes all of the exploitation loops that could be, you know, exploited by doing that. You know, getting free items, especially if you can pick up a mission where you're getting something like blueprints or, well, I've removed that, but you're getting a mission with something that's very valuable. You could game that. And so now that is no longer going to be a thing. That took quite a bit of work to go through there and figure out how to set those conditions up properly, because there's many different ways you could break it, many different ways you could mess it up. And I wanted to make sure that I put some type of failsafe for each one of those so that you could never get down that path. All right, I don't have anything in this particular save. If I was smart, I would have saved, I forget his name, Game Boyd, something like that. I would have saved his save game. He had just sent it to me to help me track down another bug. There was an issue going on with some of the mercenaries not wanting to perform their transport auto task properly because they decided that they were confused if your station that they were dropping off the ore was too close to the silo where they were picking up the ore, and it was getting them in this gray zone in between where both colliders were overlapping and creating, you know, this little bubble in between both overlaps where the ship didn't know what to do. So I have properly addressed that, and that has been fixed. And let's see, what else do we got here? I have a huge list, and I'm just kind of going off the top of my head. I should probably pull that up, but I'm not gonna. All right, let's jump over to this one, and I'll walk you through some of the planet stuff real quick. I have some plans for the planets. I know you guys have been bugging me and asking me, how can we have a space game without planets? And I said I had no use for them. I didn't want to just put the shit in the game that, you know, something as big as a planet without actually having it usable. So I have, as you can see, I've added planets or a planet object into the game. So what the planet object does and why your game update is so big, I think we had about close to a 300 megabyte update. And it has to do with the fact that these I've put together about, I don't know, 20 or 20 plus 4K textures for these planets. And oh my gosh, I've never sympathized more for the texture builders and modelers for some of these 3D games that have really high-end textures. It was so painstakingly mind-numbing that after about 6 hours of working on it, I was like, I don't want to do this again. Like, but I forced myself to at least, I think I got about 10, between 5 and 10 textures for all of the different layers. I've opened up the information. I think Archibus has posted some information on Discord. If you'd like to get into that and start to help me make some textures or improve the ones that I already have, they are not perfect. I noticed just by doing some testing last night, I found one of the textures that had a seam on it. I think it was tiling on the y-axis, and one of the seams were just not looking correct. But anyway, you will find a lot of information about that on Discord. I think it's in the modding section. He's posted what all the variables do, because in the map files now, there is one single line that will add a planet object into the map, and then you can play with all the variables on that planet object to get different colorations, different, you know, texture effects, different atmospheric effects, the animations for the clouds, the movement animations, how fast things are moving, the different rings, the different ring textures, you know, all of that stuff. And although they're not perfect quite yet, I may be doing some improvements. I was thinking about putting in a nicer sphere model so that you don't actually see those triangle edges so hard. But, you know, looking at it from this direction, yeah, it looks fine. And performance-wise, it definitely, you know, minimizing those vertices help. But I think we can get away with putting in a better little iconosphere in there, something that's a little bit smoother and make the planets look the best that they can. So I will be playing around with those. But the functionality that's going to be coming behind the planet system right now, initially. Now, I have some other ideas, and I'm not even going to throw those out there because it just opens a can of worms. But what initially is going to happen is there's going to be some type of harvesting that is able to be done from the planets. Now, this won't be the kind of harvesting where you just take your ship and fly up to an asteroid and fire up your lasers like you normally would. This will be the kind of harvesting where you're required to build energy generators and various different structures outside to build a mining outpost. And then once the mining outpost is complete, you can fire it up with some fuel, and the next thing you know, I'm thinking electron orbs right now, but I may end up crafting another item for the structure fuel. I'm not 100% sure on that. We'll start out with baby steps and work our way there if we need to. But basically, once you fire it up, it will mine raw materials. It will not mine ore. You will not have to take the ore and refine it. It will pull out oxygen and hydrogen and various different elements out of the atmospheres, which then leads you to what kind of elements will these planets have. Well, what will happen is the planets will get some type of classification. They will function very similar to the way that, you know, you can look at the various different stats of the different types of ores. Planets will be the same way. You'll be able to see what types of materials that planet has so that you can dictate, hey, look, I'm really into building ammunition. Ammunition is requiring a lot of this type of material. I found a planet that has that material. I'm going to go ahead and build my mining outpost there. And basically what happens is it mines the way, you know, it's like an AFK miner. It slowly just collects those materials until it fills up, you know, the storage bay, which, you know, like the other structures, you'll be able to upgrade and do all of the same stuff with those admins, with that admin panel that you can do with the existing structures. You'll be able to do that in your mining outpost structure that will basically allow you to manage how those materials are pulled out. Then, of course, you get real slick and sneaky, and you start putting together different silos, and next thing you know, you've got some of your mercenaries going back and forth, pulling those materials out, taking them to your station, depositing them in your storage while you're sitting in there manufacturing things. So there's a lot of these little pieces will end up tying together to allow something much bigger than the sum of its parts. So I'm really excited about some of the planetary stuff, but I got to take it slow because this is a completely new object to the game and it's a huge new mechanic that I'll be implementing. It wasn't something that I planned for early access, but I'll be damned if I couldn't help myself. Once I got over the hump with the issues I was having trying to figure out the shader programming, I couldn't stop. And I pulled probably a 72-hour stretch just fighting and wrestling with trying to figure out how to get this to work properly. And lo and behold, I got it into a functional state that I'm happy with. It seems relatively low on the resources. It doesn't seem to be jacking up your frame or dropping your frame rates or anything like that. It is, the planets are the most highly textured object in the game right now. Eventually, I would like to get better textures and work on, you know, replacing all of them, make them the best that they can be, get them all 4K. But oh my God, what a lot of work is involved in that. I can totally understand why developers pay, you know, some foreign country, you know, pennies to have their guys put all that stuff together, because it is just so monotonous and so tedious. All right, I think that pretty much covers everything that I wanted to talk about in the video. There has been, like I said, lots of little tweaks across the board in various different areas, lots of bug fixes, just little things here and that are improving the quality of life. I got some great ideas and I got some new stuff that's going to be coming, but I want to just kind of focus on polishing up all of the issues that we had with build 126 and getting it as stable as I felt the game was prior to that. And then I'm going to hit the ground running again. Technically, I shouldn't have put the planets in, but it really wasn't any mechanical thing. It was just a graphical thing. And I figured, what a better way? I'll go ahead and test the shader. You know, let everybody see, make sure we're not getting pink, you know, pink planets and weird artifacts showing up on the screen. Make sure the shader is working properly with everybody's graphics card. And then we're good to go. So what's coming next is I'm continuing to link things up with the storyline missions. I really wanted to work on the storyline stuff and try to at least get three or four more little side quests and maybe two more little storyline ones done, but I didn't. I totally fucked off and worked on these planets the whole time and didn't touch any of the scripting stuff aside from fixing. There was a few fixes that made it through, because when I'm editing those storylines, I don't want to accidentally put something into the game and people are like, hey, I just got this weird mission. It's telling me to go meet this guy I never met and to deliver this thing to my best friend who I've never spoken to. So I didn't want anything like that popping up. But some of the structures and the scripting that is already implemented into the game, any of those updates actually do propagate to the live build. So you will notice that some of the structures that had some disconnected scripts where you would see like, hey, something went wrong because the script wasn't connected. I went ahead and connected a temporary script in those places so that it doesn't, so that you're not getting an error thinking that something's broken when really it's supposed to be a storyline script that opens up into something else. So that stuff has been addressed. You're not running into any of that. And then what I'm going to be working on over the next 2 to 3 weeks, depending on how far I get, I've been working on the map editor stuff. There's been a few little tweaks that I've been doing, and I'm getting ready to pull it out of the actual game and put it into the mod tools. Just little tweaks. And one of the major things that I've been playing with was the 3D widget tool. You probably have noticed this has been something that you've seen, you know, in the devlog notes, and you're wondering what the hell that is talking about. Like, what is he talking about here? This is what I'm talking about. It's just the ability where you're going to, you know, be able to move things around using the 3D widget rather than the drag and drop, and it just gives you full control over all three axes. But this is, I mean, you can play with it. I think I only have the widget hooked up on, I think, just the Astro. I was testing on just the resources. But in the next update, I'm going to have it hooked up on everything so that I can go ahead and it just makes it a lot easier than the way I had it before. And the code is a lot cleaner as well. There was something else I wanted to show you guys too. that might be it. But anyway, so I'm going to be working on that. The two other things that I'm going to be working on is, one, the galaxy map. I'm going to be giving this some love, and the placement and the 3D-ness of it all. Like I said in the past video, yeah, it sounds cool in theory, but when you're actually using it, it just gets too messy, and I'm over it. So I'm changing the galaxy map. It's going to be a little bit more 2D-ish. I mean, you'll still have all the rotation and everything like you normally do, but I'm just going to flatten things out a little bit. I'm going to colorize and lay things out a little bit differently, put some icons where they need to be, and just try to clean things up and make it more usable. There's also a little bit of functionality issues with, you know, the zoom and zoom controls and some of the, you know, preference usability. I'm going to be making some changes to that as well. I'm also going to be changing some things here in the galaxy searching to where you're going to have some extra buttons here that are going to let you just say, show me all the stations, show me all of this, show me all of anything that I have in my journal scanned. And I realized that because I found myself going into the stations, especially when I was doing some trading, doing a lot of testing with the trade routes, working on the market economy systems. And I found it just super useful just to directly GPS to the station. So if you're not aware that you can open up your galaxy map and click this, and it will GPS you directly to the station, so that when you warp into the sector, you don't have to scroll around and try to find the station or lock anything. It'll take you right to it. So I want to make that more functional. I want to make it so that I can just list all my stations, go to that one. Okay, now I need to go over here to pick up something. I got my journal open. I'm looking at some notes. I'm trying to figure out my trade route stuff. Okay, go back to this station. I'm going to pick up that. Speaking of, I did discover a really great trade route for some of you guys that want to open up in trading in the very beginning. I was finding that you can swing through the Damon Ammunitions, pick up there's I forget what class it is. It might be class B or class C materials, and then swing by Biomate, pick up even more. And I was making almost 100,000 profit. Now you're only going to be able to do that a half dozen times or so before it's going to start affecting some of the prices and the quantities when you're clearing out the supply items. You know, you're not going to get the highest level of quantities, but starting out the game to be able to make, you know, 60, 70, 80,000 in a few short runs to be able to get into that first, you know, ship that's going to have three modules, or even if you want to go from the 400K ship up to the 900K ship to make that leap into the four module ship, active modules. It's great. So anybody who's starting out trying to figure out where to get some good runs going in the campaign map, I had started right from there from Damon Ammunitions into Biomate up to Gates of Alpharis and drop it off in Horizons. So that'll definitely get you going off the ground if you don't want to have to grind missions or do any mining to get going off the game. So the market stuff and the trading is definitely coming to life. But I will be making some changes to this stuff here. All right, I think that pretty much covers everything. There's been some tweaks to the life support system. There is one issue, I know people are going to start reporting this, that when you're playing with the module hull damage, that it's showing time here. This is going to change. What's going to happen is it's going to show that your module has taken no damage. It says no life support leaks because 100% hull integrity. And then when you're starting to take hull damage, the problem is this, the time that it's showing is not accurate any longer. The time it's showing would be with zero armor, which means you would be dead. So what this is going to do is this is going to become more dynamic because it's going to change based on the amount of damage your hull has taken. So you might be at a, you know, just take 1 point of damage from the hull and it'll show you got 10 minutes. But as soon as you take another shot, now it's showing you've only got 5 minutes because you've dropped your hull down to half. So it's going to affect the actual readout on the numbers. Now the bar will drain properly. All of the mechanics work properly. It's just the readout doesn't properly reflect what I think it should. And that was something I noticed after the update, or I would have swung that in there. But I'm going to have that fixed as well in 128. All right. I guess I could fly around and show you some planets, but I think this video is long enough, and I want to go ahead and get this uploaded. I will be doing a Twitch stream in the next couple days, if not this evening. I'll post it on the Discord and let you know, guys know what's going on. I'm going to be playing Astrox. I'll be playing the campaign map, and I'm just going to be talking shit. So come in and join me if you care, and Well, as always, you're always available to ask me questions, and I'll answer any hard ones you got. All right, guys. Well, I think that pretty much covers up everything I wanted to talk about in this update. Again, I apologize for the 3 megabyte download or the 300 megabyte download. It was a lot of textures, but I promise you it will be worth it in the end. All right, guys. Let's go ahead and wrap this up. It's Momo Guru signing out, and I will see you guys in about 2 weeks or so.